Good evening. Good evening and welcome to this 15th annual Poehler Lecture, Connecting Faith and Learning. My name is David Lump and I am Dean of the College of Arts and Letters at Concordia. This lecture is named after Concordia's third president, Dr. Willie August Poehler, and it has been made possible by the generosity of his daughter and other family members. The Poehler Lecture began and continues today as an effort to showcase how faculty members in all of the colleges and in the various disciplines honor and instantiate the mission of the university as they connect their Christian faith with their academic disciplines. This evening, we are privileged to have as our honored speaker, Dr. Cheryl Chatman, who has served with great distinction and with seemingly infinite energy and commitment as Concordia's Executive Vice President and Dean of Diversity. In keeping with the character of this event and the identity of the university, it is our custom to begin each of these events with an opening prayer. Let us pray. Triune God, we give thanks for your gifts to this university and to those who teach and serve and study here. For at its best, this is an institution where Christian conversation connects naturally with the academic disciplines your creatures have devised for understanding the world in which you have placed us. Our disciplines are not ends in themselves, but ideally settings for each one of us to be instruments of your providential care of those who need our service. In this way, we give thanks for the work and service of Dr. Cheryl Chatman, both for what she will say this evening and for her work among us over the past 16 years. In this season of Lent, we anticipate the passion of Jesus, who embodies not only service, but suffering service, a suffering to death that is the price of our redemption, and by his resurrection, a means to our abundant and eternal life. Keep this gospel at the center of our intellectual and institutional lives. We ask these things in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I now invite to the podium President Emeritus Dr. Robert Holst, himself the 10th Poehler Lecturer, who will introduce this evening's honored speaker.
Introducing Dr. Chatman is a little bit like introducing the sun and the wind. Jesus reminded us the sun warms us and the wind invigorates us, or the rain invigorates us, and God blesses us. Dr. Chatman warms us with her compassion, energizes us with her energetic service, invigorates us with her energetic service, and then blesses us because she calls on the Lord to bless us. Like a biblical prophet, Dr. Chatman will tell the truth, even though sometimes the truth hurts, but she knows that the truth helps. Like a biblical priest, sometimes she will salve us with the balm of Gilead or build bridges over troubled water because she knows that hope heals. To our benefit, her bachelor's degree from Bethune-Cookman University in Florida and her master's degree from Iowa State University and her doctorate from the University of North Carolina enriched her innate intelligence and added to her cultural insights. I don't want to sound like I'm running for president of the United States, but she is not perfect. She still does not fully celebrate our Minnesota winters. So we have still some mentoring to do. Her accomplishments are too numerous to note here. There are a few examples in the brochure. As another example of her effort and effectiveness, Until the state budget changed year after year, the Minnesota Governor's Martin Luther King Day celebration was held on the Concordia campus. Thank you, Dr. Chatman, for your efforts and your effectiveness in annually bringing thousands, literally thousands of people from the community and community leaders here to celebrate cultural reality and vision and to make more people aware of Concordia's reality and mission. For that service, the governor awarded her the Lifetime Achievement Award. Here at Concordia, for 16 years, she has served as Executive Vice President and Dean of Diversity. On behalf of all of us, Cheryl, thank you for the information, the many ideas, insights, and spiritual encouragement you have given us during your time here. You have served as God's prophet and God's priest. Finally, I introduce Dr. Chatman using some familiar words that I think give a verbal portrait of her service here. The words are from the familiar poem by that great poet, James Weldon Johnson. Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies, let it resound like the rolling seas. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark days have taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of the new day begun, let us march on till victory is won. Let us now welcome here at Concordia, where Christ is honored and all are welcome, welcome Dr. Cheryl Chatman, who will enrich our march through her Poehler Lecture. Welcome.
Wow, I have a lot to live up to. First of all, thank you, President Holst, for your gracious and generous introduction. Now I have to try to live up to at least half of what you said. Thank you, President Holst, for being a part of my calling here at Concordia, and for being a mentor and inspiration in my life. Next, I want to thank God for his constant presence in my life, through known and unknown purposes. Thirdly, I want to thank the Poehler family for their initial support of this event, and to Bruce Corey, Paul Hilmer, and the committee for inviting me to serve as the Poehler lecturer this year. My initial response to Paul and Bruce was, should I wait till I'm about to retire? And that time isn't determined yet. But they reminded me that there's no better time than the present. So here I am. I appreciate their vote of confidence and support throughout this process. Then I want to thank my right hand, my assistant, Tahara Cobb. I call her my PowerPoint manager. She developed this for me and she's going to operate it. She's been a gracious supporter of me from the beginning to the end of this preparation. I want to thank Bert Lee. I call him my project graphic designer, and you'll find out more about that later on. And to Lee Vang, she's my videographer and also my daughter. And I want to thank all the video participants for their special contributions to this presentation. One in which includes one of my sons. They're all my children, though. I appreciate all of the work behind the scenes that Susan Hanlon does to make this an enjoyable evening for all of us, and for Chad's abilities and assistance as well. Finally, there are so many of you, including Presidents Reese and Holst, the best group, you know who you are, and many others, that I want to thank you for the conversations we've had, the stories you've shared and listened to, for the information and resources you provided, and for your encouragement and prayers. Those have meant so much. Please pray with me. Gracious and merciful Father, I pray that you allow each of us to receive what you want us to see and hear tonight. May the work that we do in our positions or callings and the relationships that we have in our daily lives reflect the love and appreciation that we have for all that you have created in each of us. Amen.
Hello, I'm Dr. Michael A. Brooks, Jr., 2008 Concordia University graduate and current dental director at North Point Health and Wellness, which is a community clinic in North Minneapolis. During my times at Concordia, I have many great memories to think upon, but there are two key events that helped shape the person that I am today. The first was an opportunity that I was given as a sophomore. It was an opportunity to be the president of the student of color organization known as the MOSA, United Minds of Joint Action. By taking this opportunity, I was charged with the challenge of taking the leadership that had been instilled in me and taking it to my full potential. I had to follow in the footsteps of the presidents that have come before me, as well as take on the challenge of taking the organization to new heights. That opportunity and the challenges that came with it prepared me for the next challenge and quest that came at Concordia. As a sophomore, I was a business administration major. I was studying to become a real estate agent. But after taking my generals in chemistry and biology, I was challenged by the professors in that department to consider being a biology major. That major led me to the position I am in today, being a dentist. But it was the leadership, the compassion for others, and the thoughtfulness that was instilled in me at Concordia and was instilled upon me at Concordia that led me to where I am today. And I try every day to give that same compassion, leadership, and wisdom to my patients and to my coworkers at North Point. There's a lot of things that I could talk about as well that helped to shape who I am today. But when it pertains to those two critical events at Concordia University, they really were a key building blocks to me unlocking my potential and becoming the person that I am today. Thank you.
We are all God's Poiema. Can you see his masterpiece in me? Tonight's lecture title will guide our discussions as we come together to honor one another and share stories of God's workmanship. We will view videos like Michael's that capture the essence of this important message and hopefully lead us in seeing the masterpiece all around us. There are two suppositions that lay the foundation for what I'd like to discuss with you tonight. Number one, as individuals, families, or institutions, when we reflect and focus on our deficits and weaknesses, we limit the realization or appreciation of our strengths. Number two, as an institution of higher education, we underestimate and underutilize a critical factor that can have a profound influence on student retention and success. These suppositions will be supported throughout my message. Let me begin with a brief discussion of my lecture title. As I deliberated on the topic, I initially thought about what was at least one thing we at Concordia believed in, value, and do as a tradition. As an institution, and for many of us, we believe in God. We value the rights of others, and one tradition we follow is to have a theme of the year. We've had a theme of the year here at Concordia for nearly 30 years. The theme has a way of guiding and connecting what we focus and reflect on throughout the year. We've used the theme for academic events, concerts, tours, chapel series, and Book of the Year selections. This year's theme, coincidentally, or maybe it was by serendipity, resonated with the concept and thoughts I want to share with you tonight. So I'm going to spend a little time addressing the theme. As most of you know, our 2016 theme is We Are God's Workmanship. and it's based on Ephesians 2:10, which reads, "For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God has prepared in advance for us to do." Now let me just rephrase and strongly emphasize that again. God has already prepared, well in advance, the good works that he has created each of us to do. Jeremiah 1:5 reminds us how far in advance God has planned for our work when it tells us that God knew us before we were formed. He knew before we were born what gifts he would need from each of us and how we could be a part of his eternal purposes. They aren't often gifts we recognize or even value, but the Lord sees value in us and our gifts. He knows us better than we know ourselves or each other. We are God's workmanship. The Greek word for workmanship is poema. I was first introduced to the word through chapel services led by Pastor Tom. After hearing it a few times, I became intrigued with the word. I wanted the attraction or fascination I had for the word and its meaning to transfer to my message tonight. I hoped that the word poema would draw more attention and curiosity to the lecture, which is something we should always maintain when it comes to God's words, attention and curiosity. So poema means that which has been made or is the result of someone's work. It is something made by God himself. We are God's workmanship, his masterpiece, his work of art, his divine poetry. We are a result of God's powerful and creative activity. In God, we are a new creation. It may be hard for us to imagine or see ourselves as a masterpiece, but when we look at ourselves this way, we begin to understand the incredible value and worth that we all have in God. We are each uniquely and creatively made. We're one of a kind, a work of art, custom designed. In all of the ages in life, there has never been and never ever will be another man or woman like you or me. If God can create and have a plan for all of his creation, the sky, the stars, birds of the air, snowflakes, or rain, he can truly be trusted to have a plan and a purpose for each of our lives. Each life is a fresh thought of God, his own masterpiece. We need to celebrate that and celebrate each other's uniqueness. This poem captures this point. You are special. Created by the hands of God himself, awakened by his breath, filled with his spirit, redeemed by his blood, live by his love, for none on this earth could be measured equal to you. So live as what you are supposed to be, the masterpiece of God.
My name is Sadia. I attend Concordia. I am a junior, and my major is elementary education. I'm from Somalia. My parents took us from the Civil War to Minnesota. It was challenging growing up in the United States because I had to adapt to a different culture. Technically, I grew up here because I was 2 when I escaped the Civil War in Africa. It was a challenging experience being an American and Somali. One of the most influential people in my life was my mentor. She was my middle school counselor. She really told me to express myself in not just feelings, but express myself into paper. So I started writing about my experiences, and I started sharing it, and she really wanted to know my story, and she took her time from her busy schedule to have conversations with me and just see me as a human being and not just a sad story. So she built my confidence in a way, and hopefully by next year I will be graduating with my major, and I'll be the first one to graduate in my family.
Okay, most of you who know me and my style know that I like audience participation. Well, guess what? This message won't be any different. Don't get nervous. I won't cause you to feel uncomfortable yet. This first level of participation will just be a mental one. So I'm going to begin with a few questions that I'd like for you to reflect on now and throughout our time together. Has there ever been a time in your life when you felt invisible, overlooked, or misunderstood? If so, think about that for a few moments, on at least one of the times, when and where this occurred, and maybe what happened or led up to you feeling that way. Did it happen occasionally, or was it an ongoing feeling with those who you were involved in or in the place that it occurred? Did their words turn your world upside down? Well, on the flip side, have you ever had someone see something in you that you didn't see in yourself? Was there a time where someone just lifted you up? Do you remember how it made you feel? What impact did that have on you, immediately and or long term? Did it make you feel that you could accomplish anything or much more than you were doing? I know these are a lot of questions to reflect on for just a few minutes, but I was trying to help you recreate those time periods in your mind so that you could help me set the tone. Your reflections may help identify some of the things that I want to share tonight. As educators, our challenge and our joy is helping students move to levels of personal excellence by becoming the persons they have the potential to be. And the marvelous thing about this perspective is that in the process, we also move to our own personal excellence by becoming the persons we have the potential to be. Chip Anderson. Treat people as if they were what they ought to be, and you help them become what they are capable of being. Gutha. Okay, so going back to my first premise, as individuals and families, we spend far too much time reflecting, focusing, and commenting on our deficits and our weaknesses. By consistently engaging in this train of thought, we limit the realization or appreciation of our strengths. Tom Rath, author of Strengths Finder, states it well when he says, "All too often, our natural talents go untapped. From the cradle to the cubicle, we devote more time to fixing our shortcomings than to developing our strengths." Rath worked with Donald Clifton, the late father of strengths psychology, and a team of Gallup scientists to start a global conversation about what's right with people. He states that they were tired of living in a world that revolved around fixing our weaknesses. He felt that society's relentless focus on people's shortcomings had turned into a global obsession. They believe that people have several times more potential for growth if there's an investment in developing their strengths rather than correcting their deficiencies. I didn't conduct a campus survey as I was tempted to do, but I have enough testimonies where students have described to me situations where they have felt inadequate or overlooked. They expressed feelings of being overwhelmed, feeling hopeless, discouraged, or discounted. Many expressed feelings of being mistrusted, misbelieved, or doubted for what they said or did. A few others have felt humiliated or stripped of their pride. In some situations, I could hear where students could have done things differently, but in many cases, I wondered how they could have been led to do things a different way or encouraged to not give up. I want to acknowledge early on that I realize that there are times that students fail to comply with or fulfill some of the basic requirements. But these might be critical times to seek the best in students, even when we may see the worst of their efforts.
Hi, my name is Lee Vang, and I'm a 2002 graduate of Concordia University, St. Paul. Currently, I work as a personalized learning specialist for St. Paul Public Schools. I specialize in the logistics for our one-on-one iPad initiative, and I'm also the creator of our student tech leaders known as the Genius Squads. One of the main things that I remember from Concordia was coming to school every day and being content with being invisible. I would arrive on campus, attend my classes in the science building, and go home. I remember the first time I met the Dean of Diversity, she questioned me about my involvement on campus and in general my feelings about campus life and being part of a larger community. I was uncomfortable because I really was going home every day and just coming to school and not getting involved and being engaged with my peers. I think I would have been able to survive my college career in that mode, but I felt very blessed that I ran into her, and she really inspired in me a lot of hidden passion and excitement and enthusiasm for being part of a larger community and nurturing skills and traits that otherwise would have been hidden and remained stagnant had it not been for meeting her. Because of my involvement with her, I feel like it really further nourished me in becoming who I am today. I am a deep believer of planting seeds in people. Sometimes just the smallest idea that you give someone can really inspire them to be something bigger and better. Today, I feel like that is the same role and same service I want to provide back. You know, today I serve St. Paul students. I provide them with access and opportunities that they might not have been able to earn any other way or may not have been able to experience. But more importantly, I just feel like I'm a grower. You know, my love is to plant seeds in people so that they can have an idea or just fathom the chance. You know, give them an opportunity to really dream bigger and do things that they might not have imagined. And that is what empowers me and inspires me to come to work every day and to be a contributing member of a larger community and to find purpose in my life. And I am thankful every day that I found someone who provided me with that insight and this passion.
Words can be so powerful. They can build up hope or tear down dreams. They can provide inspiration or discouragement. There are some words people have said to me that I can't get out of my head, still today. Both haunting and inspiring words. What messages are we giving to students or our colleagues through our words or our silence? It doesn't mean that we need to ignore or dismiss areas that need work or improvement, but we don't have to stop there. We need to look deeper. People are more than what we see. We seem to be far more certain of our weaknesses and what we aren't skillful in that we practically deny the strengths and possibilities that may exist. There may be some strengths that can even be annoying. But at some point in time, that very gift of talent can be and will be useful. We need to thank God for every gift He's given us. Everyone is good at and a potential expert at something. What's second nature to you may be more challenging for others, but that doesn't make their gifts less important or valuable. Let's not discredit anyone just because they don't have the same or visible gifts. We can utilize and capitalize on their strengths. As faculty, we don't always realize the power and authority our voices have on students. We sometimes make assumptions that students know or see things the way we see them. Sometimes it just requires a mere question or example or suggestion. An example of this is one day when a colleague mentioned the idea of going to graduate school to one of her students. She later found out the student had never even considered graduate school. No one had ever talked to her about going to graduate school, the possibility of it, but the professor's assumption that she was going gave her a vision of possibilities and hope for further education. It's interesting how one moment or just a few words can change or redirect someone's life. Another example involved a student who, although in good standing, began missing classes. The professor's opinion of the student's commitment to the class began to decline until the student took the initiative to explain how her family depended on her for important family matters, even when it occurred during class. The professor was then introduced to a different set of cultural values. Her family values were prioritized as education first, family second. For the student, it was just the reverse. Family first, education second. We need to find ways to learn and consider the values of all of our cultures. Another colleague shared his experience as a student when a professor asked what was going on when his attendance and performance had a noticeable change. It encouraged the student to know that his professor cared enough to just ask what's going on. Many of us are familiar with this scripture, 1 Corinthians 12, chapter 4 through the 11. Now, there are a variety of gifts, but the same Spirit. Variety of services, but the same Lord. Varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activates all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses. Let's now examine and learn from how the greatest resources of our faith, the Bible, records God using the gifts of various individuals for specific purposes. There are numerous stories that illustrate God or Jesus looking deeper inside individuals' potential despite their doubts and weaknesses, but I'm just going to share a few. Why don't we start at the beginning in Genesis, where Joseph's brothers not only hated him for the favoritism he received from his father Jacob, they also didn't want to acknowledge his gift of interpreting dreams. The brothers went to extreme efforts to get rid of Joseph. Despite selling him for 20 pieces of silver, Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh's court, saw his gifts and talents and appointed him overseer of his house. God's plan and purpose for Joseph didn't stop there. Because of his gift of interpreting dreams, Joseph won Pharaoh's attention and favor. He became food administrator during a time of famine and ended up reuniting and blessing the brothers that didn't support who he was and what he was gifted to do. Then in Exodus, God chose Moses to lead the Israelites out of Egypt to the promised land, despite his feelings of inadequacy regarding his speaking impediment. This story has some interesting twists, which included Moses' life being at stake from the beginning, when Pharaoh ordered midwives to kill all of the Hebrew males at birth. Not only was Moses' life saved by his mother and sister, his mother became his nurse through the adoption by Pharaoh's daughter. God always had a plan for Moses to be a powerful leader. He fulfilled the purpose God created in him to achieve, despite the challenges on the journey and the resistance and lack of faith from his people. Even Jesus choosing Simon, called Peter, and his brother Andrew shows that God uses people that others may overlook. I'm told that in those days, rabbis chose the brightest to be students striving to be rabbis, the most respected people of the day. It's likely, I don't have actual proof, but it's likely that Simon and Andrew didn't make the cut to be rabbis. But Jesus saw fit to choose them as his followers, and they became fishers of men. God can use anyone for his good and our good. Finally, I want to be sure to include a woman among my biblical reflections. Ooh, and by the way, International Women's Day, ooh, shout out for the women, woo, woo. Yes, let's give the women a hand. International, woo, woo. Louder, louder, woo. We won't even start talking about what life would be out without women. We won't even go there tonight. So, God's plan for Esther had an impact on a nation and the world. She was a Jewish orphan who became a Persian queen. When Haman wanted a wholesale massacre of all the Jews in the kingdom, Esther broke all protocol, risked her life, and entered the king's chambers without an invitation. She stood up and spoke out and asked the king to spare the lives of her people. Despite the turmoil and strife Esther and her people were in, God placed her in the kingdom for such a time as this. She used her opportunity, her resources, and she saved a nation. There are endless examples of God and Jesus' plan and purpose for the lives of his masterpieces, specifically designed to have a positive impact on the world. How much more does he have plans for you and me? Even with our imperfections or doubt, God wants to use all of us to fulfill his purposes. He wants to use us for such a time as this. 2 Corinthians 12, chapter 9 through 10 reminds us that my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. God makes me strong. I've never met a person who was perfect or could do everything well. And when I do, I'll know I'll be in heaven.
Hello, my name is Joe Dorr. I'm a senior here at Concordia University. I'm a business management major, and there was one point in my life where I was about to drop out at Concordia. And at this point, I was dealing with personal issues. I was going through some mental illness issues, and my grandmother was in poor health. So I was going through a lot of personal things and was ready to drop out of college altogether. One moment in time is when I went to a professor's office and just talked to him about how I'm struggling with certain things in my life. And the one thing that really touched me is that he reached out to me and said, you can come every Friday and you can talk to me every Friday. And him reaching out to me really inspired me to continue here at Concordia University. And because of this inspiration, now I'm applying to grad school and hopefully I'll be graduating with an MBA here at Concordia University.
Now I'd like to move to my second premise. As an institution of higher education, we underestimate and underutilize a critical factor that can have a profound influence on student retention and success. Higher education should not be higher by virtue of serving the rich, the well-born, the academically able and advantaged, or those destined to fill the academic ranks. Rather, it shall be higher because it takes an adult or near adult beyond his or her present level toward a fuller realization of his or her powers to be. B.J. Solwoodell. I believe that we as an institution of higher education have the capability, the responsibility, and the opportunity to capitalize on one of the most powerful change agents and major factors in influencing student success and retention. In my opinion, this key factor has been underestimated, underrated, and as I mentioned, underutilized for far too long. I refer to it as missed opportunities. That factor is none other than the intentional, deliberate, and specific identification and affirmation of God's workmanship. His creativity and his gifts that are in all of our students. The focus of my message tonight is on seeking, identifying, and nurturing God's Poiema in our current students. The Poehler Lectures are centered on faith and learning, so I hope that we all can find application for what's shared and for the work and interactions we have with coworkers, families, neighbors, and friends. After all, we're all lifelong learners, but tonight is specifically focused on students. So here's another audience participation moment. But again, it'll be done silently, yes. Okay, so we know it's not uncommon at an institution of higher education to have periods of testing one's knowledge, right? You can relax. It's just a one-question quiz that you're about to take, and it won't require a study guide, a long essay, and it won't be graded. You just need to select what alphabet reflects your best response to the question based on your knowledge and perspectives and experiences. So the question is, what factor or factors has or have the greatest impact on student retention or success? Is it academic ability, teaching style, motivation, personal relationships, level of self-esteem, a support system, or affirmation? Select your answer. Okay. Have you chosen a response? Do you have personal experience or evidence of why you chose the one you did as the best answer? What responses have you been gifted to affect or influence? So actually, I have to admit that it was sort of a trick question just to gear you to think about student success. Of course, each response has a profound impact on a student's success. The best response will vary depending on the class, campus climate, life situations, professor, et cetera, student. I didn't include the best response because it would have made the answer too easy. We don't like easy questions, right? But in reality, the best answer, which would be H, all of the above. But even all of them, they're not that easy to accomplish. It is something that I hope and trust that we at Concordia St. Paul will continue to strive toward finding ways to address, support, and encourage all of the above in our various roles and responsibilities. Students fail to do well in college for a variety of reasons, and only one of them is lack of academic preparedness. Factors such as personal autonomy, self-confidence, ability to deal with racism, study behaviors, or social competence have as much or more to do with grades, retention, and graduation than how well a student writes or how competent a student is in mathematics. Hunter Borland. In an article entitled 10 Ways Faculty Can Support Success, Helping Students Achieve the Six Factors, this study was done by the Student Support Redefine Study Group in 2013. The responses of nearly 900 community college students in California helped to create a ranked by importance list of success factors. After interviewing practitioners and researchers and conducting a review of leading studies and effective support practices, the RP group has identified the following six factors that impact students' success of achievement. They feel the six things that students need to be is directed, focused, nurtured, engaged, connected, and valued. In terms of being directed, students need to have a goal and know how to achieve it. To be focused, they need to stay on track, keeping their eyes on the prize. To be nurtured, they need to feel somebody wants and helps them to succeed. To feel engaged, they participate in class and extracurricular activities. And we heard from previous videos the impact that can have. To be connected, they need to feel that they are a part of the college community. And to feel valued, their skills, talents, abilities, and experiences are recognized if they have opportunities to contribute on campus and feel that their contributions are appreciated. We can all play a role in supporting and encouraging students on any of these factors. In search of more indicators of success, a team of researchers, including the American Council on Education, the Kentucky Council on Post-Secondary Education, George Kuh, they all and other researchers presented a report entitled What Matters to Student Success, a review of literature done in 2006. This report was commissioned by the National Symposium on Secondary Student Success, spearheading a dialogue on student success. So here are a few of the highlights that I'll go through pretty briefly. They find that the single best predictor of student success or student satisfaction with college is the degree to which they perceive the college environment to be supportive of their academic and social needs. For most students, the more interaction with faculty, the better. Both substantive and social out-of-class contacts with faculty members appear to positively influence what students get from their college experience, their views of the college environment, the quality of personal relations, and their satisfaction. Perceptions directly affect student satisfaction and how much effort students will expend on educationally purposeful activities, which consequently have direct effects on their learning and personal development. Out-of-class contacts appear to positively shape students' perceptions of the campus environment and seem to positively influence educational aspirations and degree completion. Although the reason for this relationship is not clear, it seems likely when faculty engage students outside the classroom and these interactions are positive, students may feel affirmed and develop a stronger bond with the institution. These interactions may reinforce a student's initial goals and deepen the commitment to graduate. Perhaps meeting and talking with faculty members empowers students to do more than they think they can and helps validate them as full members of the campus community, which in turn legitimates their presence and makes them more comfortable to reach out and become engaged in a variety of activities. Students who find something or someone worthwhile to connect to in the post-secondary environment are more likely to engage in educationally purposeful activities, persist, and achieve their educational objectives. Student-faculty interaction beyond the classroom is positively correlated with personal growth in the areas of leadership, social activism, and intellectual self-esteem, and academic as well as social self-concept. Such interactions include the hours per week spent talking with the faculty outside the classroom, assisting faculty in teaching a class, working on a professor's research project, or serving on committees with faculty. Now, I'm not proposing that every faculty member can have this level of interaction and involvement with each student. The needs of students vary greatly. The goal is to be aware, willing, and responsive. Or we can use our tagline to be responsive, relevant, and real. Our interactions, words, and actions can have a huge impact on students' self-efficacy. Later, I'll share some brief, extended, and specific ways that we can have a greater impact on student retention and success. I've received permission from the Irreducible Grace Foundation. This happens to be an organization that Michael Dorner is the board chair. I received permission from this organization, which assists youth to develop and repair emotional trust in adults while planning and achieving their college, career, and life goals, to share an excerpt from Brandon Wilson, 20. He's a 20-year-old workshop coordinator for the foundation. And this is found in their book that they publish, Fostering Voice. Brandon writes, I wish that people took the time to hear my story. I wish that people wouldn't judge on first look. I wish that everyone would listen, teach, and inspire. Another poem entitled Masterpiece by Jesse J reads, I still fall on my face sometimes, and I can't color inside the lines. I'm perfectly incomplete. I'm still working in my masterpiece. I want to hang out with the greats. Got a way to go, but it's worth the wait. No, you haven't seen the best of me. I'm still working on my masterpiece. Imagine with me for a moment, what would it look and feel like if every student could walk the halls of Concordia in and out of the classrooms, in and off campus, and truly believe that she or he had a gift or talent that was so valuable that it could make contributions that would be worthwhile here at Concordia or in life. Can you imagine that with me for a moment? Can you imagine the satisfaction that could come from this self-worth, even in the midst of failures or disappointments? Do we feel confident in the things that God has purposed or destined us to do? God made us with the ability to reflect his character in our love and faithfulness. Knowing that we are created in God's image and thus share many of his characteristics provide a solid basis for self-worth. Human wealth is not based on possessions, achievements, physical appearance, or public acclaim. Social status, race, gender, or nationality are not the sole qualifiers. Instead, it is based on being created in God's image. Because we bear God's image, we can feel positive about ourselves. We all want and need affirmation throughout our life. Don't you feel better when somebody recognizes or acknowledges your gifts or contributions? Don't you? Okay. Knowing that we are persons of worth makes us valuable contributions to those around us. In this era of innovation, we should be educating to our creative strengths instead of eroding the characteristic that enable people to thrive. So what message are we giving our students? We give strong messages through our eyes, through direct looks, to avoidance of eye contact. We give messages through our actions or inactions, through our words, acknowledgments, and our silence. Students can detect our intentions. As a calling, we invest care and support for student success. More importantly, it's who you teach, not what you teach. We have a gift and a calling to inspire others. We should bless as we are blessed. What if we could all ask the questions, what can I do to help this student to have one of the most successful experiences possible here at Concordia? What can I do to help him or her reach their potential? Are we doing all that we can do to help a student believe and have hope? How far are we expected to go, or how much should we be willing to do? How much time would that take? Do we sometimes treat or value gifts differently? Are there gifts we think are more important or better than others? Would you want to be totally summed up or judged by your weaknesses? So look around, in front of you, behind you, to the side. Can you see God's masterpiece in each other? Ooh, I hope so. We need x-ray vision. But guess what? The beauty, gifts, and talents from God are oftentimes hidden and not necessarily visible by the eye. But do we still believe that it's not there? Do you still think there's not a masterpiece there? If God considers us his works of art, we dare not treat ourselves or others with disrespect or as inferior work. Who are we to question or doubt how God designed the poem, the art, the masterpiece in you or me? Do we think we know more or better than God? Do we have the right to tell him how he should have tweaked, adjusted, fine-tuned, or eliminated some aspects of who we are? Can we improve on the master's work? I don't think so. What we can do is to seek, acknowledge, and celebrate it. And we'll talk more about this later on in the message. So now you may be wondering, how can I do this in my course, field, job, family, or in community? Am I not doing enough already? I'm glad you asked that question. As Joseph Kavanaugh III, who was one of our speakers here on campus earlier last year, points out in his book, The Language of Blessing, God has chosen us to be vehicles of his blessing to each other. We are blessed to be a blessing. It's a privilege to be able to affirm and motivate each other to acts of love and good works. People often think good thoughts of others, but they seldom express those thoughts in words. Kavanaugh claims that what is lacking is a robust language to affirm and bless one another. He says that the ability to recognize and affirm gifts, talents, and character in others is an essential part of giving the blessing. Here's what he suggests for becoming a master at blessing. Number one, he suggests to demonstrate intentionality and commitment. He states that the words of blessing will transform another person's life, but they require an investment of time and effort. For our words to take root, those we seek to bless must view our words of affirmation as authentic and offer it without any agenda other than their good. We listen with respect and focused interest so we can know and understand another person. We ask insightful questions to show our growing understanding and genuine interest in the person. Number two, become a student of the other person. Kavanaugh says, if you want to be a master gardener, you have to learn the unique requirements of all the plants you wish to grow. Becoming a master of blessing requires that you become a student of those you love and desire to bless. He adds that you can create a starting point for you and the student or coworker or neighbor or family or friend to talk about his or her strengths, inborn traits, and motivators. Thirdly, he says, look for a person's internal motivators. He believes that each of our gifts and talents has powerful intrinsic motivators. All people have within them a potential fire in the belly, one or more internal drivers that enable them to develop the gifts within, let their light shine, achieve great things, and contribute their unique genius to the world. He asserts that many people have not had their gifts and talents recognized and affirmed. What should be a raging fire within is only a smoldering ember, barely noticeable, even to the individual. This ember, he says, needs to be coaxed to life. They can become what Kavanaugh describes as the cycle of false identity. Identifying smoldering embers and fanning them into flames can be a part of our life's mission. One's passion can be so beaten down that the individual is almost invisible. People need to feel truly accepted and valued, and we need to keep paying it forward. What Kavanaugh describes as the cycle of false identity, I'd like to describe as the cycle of unidentified gifts and talents. I'm going to tell this quick story, but I'm watching the time. I was talking to a high school friend recently about this message I was going to do. And so I was talking about, I remember when I was young, I didn't know what my talent was. I used to say, I don't have a talent. And when I was in high school, this is right after integration, it was the first year, they were trying to get as many people involved in all levels. So they talked me into running for this contest. I was not planning on doing this, so we have to be talked into things. And when it was time for the contest, usually with the contest you have to do a talent, and I said, I don't have a talent. What talent am I going to do? It's almost as if we sometimes feel if we don't have a talent that can be shown on stage, that we don't have a talent. That's what I thought when I was young. I'm like, what can I get up there to do? I usually talked and did orations for different things, so I knew I had that part. So with the help of others and some encouragement, I did end up doing the talent. I got third place, hey, okay. But so even though I thought I didn't have a talent, I made it work, okay? So again, it was through the encouragement of others, noticing something in me I didn't see. And my girlfriend said, I remembered you saying you didn't have a talent. And we thought what you did was great. And we thought you did have a talent. I'm still saying today, I forced that talent, okay? But I have later on discovered a couple more talents. Again, they still may not be able to be done on stage, okay? So I believe that a lot of students have not received the affirmation and encouragement. So we have what I call a lot of unidentified, and I'll name some of these roles that people have. We have a lot of students who have not identified their gifts, their purposes, their callings. And they're walking around Concordia, in classes and everywhere. What I think we have, we may be missing out on some future ambassadors, activists, change agents. They could be sitting right next to you. Entrepreneurs, interpreters, inventors, liberators, lifesavers, organizers, peacemakers, presidents, rescuers, social justice fighters. They're yet to be discovered. Again, look around. These people might be right in the midst of you. We don't know for what purposes God has given anyone. So Lord, remind us that the gifts you give may not be the ones the world values, but may be the ones that could save a life, minister to the poor, care for the earth, fill a void. Every gift has its use and value throughout our lifetime. Recently, we celebrated the humanities here on campus. That was a beautiful display of the unique gifts and abilities of our faculty, staff, and guests. The artists admired and were admired by the authors. The skills of the historians were pronounced in different ways than the musicians. Everyone had something masterful to share. Society as a whole must respect, defend, and promote the dignity of every person at every moment and in every condition of that person's life. Pope John Paul. I'm nearing the end, so bear with me. Can you imagine what life in the world would be like if we had all the same gifts, interests, passions, or if everyone's uniqueness and abilities weren't available or utilized? There would be a lot of things uncovered or overlooked. Can you conceive of what would happen in our daily lives with all that we use and depend on if we didn't have people with those specific gifts? How would we get to the other side of the ocean or world without engineers and architects or mechanics? What about those who provide help to produce food and process things for our basic needs? Clothing, especially in cold Minnesota. Ooh, I'm so thankful for the gift, those who can sew, make wool, make warm clothes, thermal. Thank you, God, for those gifts. And how would we survive without the internet? Young people are like, unspeakable. Can't imagine that, right? But you get my point, right? If we all could do the same things, a lot of stuff would not be taken care of. So, due to our limited search and encouragement and valuing of individual gifts, our students and others in our lives are not discerning their purpose or calling. Partially because their strengths haven't been identified or nurtured. We need to be strength finders, helping people see and understand what they haven't realized or affirmed. Too often we underestimate the power of a touch, a smile, a kind word, a listening ear, an honest compliment, or the smallest act of caring. All of which have the potential to turn a life around. Leo Buscaglia. I'm gonna go through this real quick, and I'm about to wrap up, because it's good to talk about what's needed and what's lacking, but sometimes people want some specific application. How can I make this happen? So there's a long list here, and I'm gonna sweep through them quickly. These are just few brief ways of affirming and supporting students that have been suggested by students, staff, and faculty, some of you, including things that either have happened to them or things that they have done in their work. And I'm going to tell you, you were blessed. I had to cut this list in half, so, with advice. Okay, so real quickly. With advice to some people, I won't call any names, my husband and other people. Yeah, okay. My auntie, too long. Okay. One of my gifts is being verbose. Ooh, let's praise that gift. Ooh, I like it. Okay. Okay. Quickly, simply showing acts of kindness with smiles. I just said that. Building relationships, so important. Mutual respect. I mentioned how person just asks, when something has changed, is everything okay? How are you? Using the three E's, encourage, be honest, be open. Use words of assurance in and out of the classroom. Even if they failed a class, if there's something good that you saw in that student, help point that out. Provide leadership. Let's see, I have a note here about a professor who did this. And receive feedback from a student. Okay, there was a professor that was in a class and gave the student opportunity to lead. And she didn't realize later on, the student said, I always wanted to get in front and lead. And you gave me that opportunity. Show the human side. I keep it real. So that's what I'm saying, keep it real, all right? But I know some people are a little more reserved. So this list, you don't have to do everything, but hopefully you'll find some things. be a mentor, maintain high expectations, respect students, and even those high expectations, are they reflected in your course syllabus? Here's another suggestion. Learn something about students. I went to a class and I said, what is it that you would like from professors so that you feel better connected or you think you could be more connected with or more successful? The student said it would be nice if they did at the beginning of a class, did a little survey and asked what we were interested in, what are our dreams, goals, learning style. The student said if they would just get to know us a little bit. So professors are sitting here thinking, one more thing to add. Okay, but maybe you could cut out something else on that syllabus. Okay, but remember, this can contribute to retention. Show you believe in them. Ooh, all of you can relate to this. How many of you feel so much better when you know somebody believed in you? I got to tonight because so many people believed in me. I wasn't sure I was ready to say it was going to be all that, but a lot of people believed. It helps to have someone believed in you. There's a lot of stress, unhealthy stress, when people are anxious. So it doesn't take a lot of time to do even a few of these. You don't have to do the exhaustive list. A few things to remember. Remember to be certain that you establish your priorities and that they're not established for you. Remember that it's not what you say sometimes, but how you say it. Remember that everyone wants to be wanted and everyone is needed. Remember that faith is a higher faculty than reason. Philip Bailey said that. Remember that as long as there is breath, there is hope. When you think you can't do something or dig deeper or do any more, you'll find that you can give more. As final evidence of the impact faculty, staff, families, and community members can have, we have one last video from one of our alum. I hit it too many times. Pardon? Oh, hit play. Oh, I thought I did.
Hello. My name is Tahir Shamsabari Cobb. I grew up in South Minneapolis, Minnesota, and I graduated with my degree in psychology and minored in family studies from Concordia University, St. Paul. And I am currently the program coordinator for diversity affairs here at CSP. Throughout my life, I have been blessed with role models, leaders, and mentors that I could look up to. And despite the many adversities I have faced, they have always been there when I've needed them the most. I was offered an opportunity to work for the Office of Higher Education through an outreach initiative program, educating and informing high school girls about college. So for my first session, I decided that I would use my own personal story of how I got to where I am today and what they could do now to start preparing themselves. And when I was finished, the director of the program came up to me and she was so impressed with the way I was able to grab the girls' attention and how much they could really relate to my story. And when she said that, it was in that moment that I realized I am not just the girl who barely graduated high school. I am not just the girl who had to work a full-time job to help her family pay bills and make ends meet. And I'm not just the girl who would become a product of her environment. But instead, I am the woman who could make a difference in the lives of people like me, underprivileged youth who are systematically oppressed. So I encourage and challenge you to look beyond your own biases, your own prejudices, or anything that may hinder you from seeing God's workmanship in every individual. I have always thought to myself that no matter how great you think you are standing on the shoulders of those who have come before you, those who have helped you get to where you are today. So pay it forward.
Okay, my last promise, and this is the end, but you can tell me if you want to shoot this down. This is sort of a opportunity for you to have some input. This is the last audience participation, but this one is real. Okay, we're going to do it. Spare me 10 more minutes. But what I want you to do for 1 minute, turn to the person to your left or right, and if there isn't a person to your left or right, to the back. And if you're uncomfortable, this is good. This means progress. if you're uncomfortable doing this, because if you're not willing to do this now, then my whole speech is almost like my whole message is in vain. Because the thing that you're supposed to do is be able to, okay, the thing you need to be able to do is talk to someone and share. So what I want you to do is take a moment, and we have a few instructions up there. Take 30 seconds apiece, or maybe you need a minute. I want you to either share a time where you felt that your gifts, talents, or strengths were invisible or overlooked and so forth, or you can do the reverse, a time when someone pointed out to you what you were able to do. Was there a time where someone in your life made you feel special, capable, competent, able to accomplish anything? Okay, I'm gonna need you to do that now, and then we're gonna wrap it up. So turn to the person next to you, share a time where, and I know some people are like, I don't like this, but if we don't start doing this now, it's not gonna ever happen. And you said you wanted to come, hear me, work with me, okay? I won't know what you're saying, but try to do it. I love the sound that I'm hearing. I love the sound that I'm hearing. Because what I'm hearing, the buzzing that I'm hearing, are people sharing their stories. And there's just so much power in people sharing their stories. Not only sharing, but there's power in people hearing your stories. You can continue what you didn't finish afterwards at the reception, okay? And I'm willing to listen to anyone who wants to share their story later on in the week. Okay, so here's the wrap up. As I hope you found that experience valuable. As I'm nearing the end of my message, in an effort to promote and encourage everyone's ability to see God's masterpiece in each other, I want to start a campaign for change. This is the season of campaigns. Mine is more positive. The name of my campaign is the Now Move It campaign. Now, at first, that sounds a little abrupt. It has sort of a military tone. Now move it. But it's quite the opposite. Instead, it's a call to action. Again, some of you who know me know that I like acrostics or acronyms. So let's look at what these letters stand for. What does Now Move It stand for? First of all, I want to acknowledge that this button was totally designed by Bert Lee, a graphic design major. Bert, where are you? Wave your hand, Bert. Stand up. Woo-hoo! Bert is active on and off campus. I didn't even know Bert's gifts. I was trying to use Tahara's gifts, and she tried to use his, and so I found out about him. So you don't have to figure it out on your own. Somebody can help you figure somebody's talent if you don't see it. Bert even worked on this we communicated over the holidays. He treated me like a real client. He was so professional. I was like, whoa, okay, Bert. So this is the result. So this is what Now Move It stands like. It's just not in order. Now stands for noticing one's worth, not their weakness, not just focusing on their weakness. That's my grandson. Hey, go Zephaniah. Woo, I planted him out there. Woo, woo, thank you, Zephaniah. Move is finding moments of valuing and encouraging. That's my other grand, I think. Okay. And the it is, hey, y'all, it's time. So now watch this. Bert was so talented. You just thought you saw those letters. In each of the letters, he incorporated the words of moving it, you know, noticing the worth, the encouragement, all the things of my messages. He actually interviewed me so he could see what this button should be about. And he was very skillful. So what I did was had some buttons made, because I don't want this to end tonight. You know, you come to a lecture, and sometimes you forget in a month what was said. If you don't remember anything else, I want you to remember that you need to move it. So I had these buttons made. I wasn't sure how many people wanted one, so I only had so many made. And I wasn't sure how to distribute them or so forth. So I was like, don't feel forced. I'm not going to watch and see who picks a button up and who doesn't. I'm not going to look on campus and see who's not wearing the button. I'm not going to come in your office and see if it's not in there. But if you don't want to wear it, you can at least hang it in the hallway in your department, right? Like hang it on the bulletin board. You could put it on a backpack or whatever. But don't feel compelled to take one. But it might be noticed if you don't know. This is my closing prayer. Lord, we pray that you will help us to bless before we judge and to see your presence in moments of weakness and of strength. Help us to be mindful of all the ways that you have created greatness, uniqueness, poetry, a masterpiece in everyone. Amen. Who you are is God's gift to you. You've heard this before. And who you become is your gift and our gift to God. So, as a 2016 Poehler Lecturer, I hereby appoint each of you a strength finder, a talent seeker, an investigator of skills, an interpreter of truth, a discoverer of masterpieces. Use your faith, your compassion, your empathy, your Christian values, and your X-ray vision. We are all God's poema. Can you see his masterpiece in you and me? Are you ready to take on these roles and actions? If so, say yes. Okay, now move it. Amen.
I want to tell you, I'm going to be wearing my button tomorrow. So thank you. Oh, man. I think it's so typical that Cheryl is asked to be the Poehler Lecturer for 2016, and what does she do but engage about 250 people, probably 300, including all of us, in sharing the message. Thank you for the time that you spent in asking those students and alumni to speak, which is so typical of you. Let's have others deliver the message. And yet you are such a great leader and modeler, and you led from the podium tonight, so we do appreciate this. Cheryl's one of the fun things that Cheryl has said over the years is that she enjoys giving bouquets to the living. I don't know if you've ever heard her say that, but of course the idea is that lots of people bring flowers to somebody after they passed, and she wants to do that while they're living. I don't know if she'll bring flowers to my funeral when I'm gone, probably not. And probably rightly so, because she's been so generous with her praise and encouragement to me personally, and I know to almost all of us in this room. So it's just a delight to be associated with you, and just a wonderful, wonderful experience to hear you speak this evening. God bless you. We have a little plaque for you, presented to Cheryl T. Chapman, Poehler Lecture Series, Connecting Faith and Learning, and gratitude for your presentation on March 8th, 2016, Concordia University, St. Paul. So we want to see that hanging on your wall next to your button.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Now, immediately after this, there is a reception in the lobby just to my right and your left, and Cheryl will be out there, and she said she wants to listen to all your problems as well as your as your gifts and talents. Oh, I thought it was tonight yet. All right. Well, you're up all night anyway. I do want to recognize and thank, I know Teddy Keppen is here representing the Poehler family. Teddy, nice to see you again. And Dr. and Mrs. Poehler's daughter, she is a big fan of Concordia even to this day. She dashed into my office about 3 weeks ago with a newspaper from Edina, where the readers of that Edina newspaper had named Concordia University St. Paul the best university in Minnesota. She goes, "What's going on in Edina?" So thanks, Teddy, for your enthusiasm for Concordia. And as I mentioned, we want to invite all of you to greet Dr. Chapman and to enjoy our fellowship in the lobby. So God bless you. Wonderful to have you here, and we'll see you in a few minutes.